started with my PhD at Biomedical Center at LMU, and I will talk about flies, fruit fly particularly, that I'm working with, and I find it fascinating, and I would like you to know more about that, and actually to learn why we using and how we can benefit from a study of a fly that's had nothing in the first glance common with a human. So, what about organisms? Organisms that scientists use in a lab called model organisms, and we do experiments with them to learn what drugs, to discover drugs, or to learn what particular disease mean and how it refers and all this stuff. And it's all okay and nice when it's come like to mice or rabbits, plants, because they're mammals like me, and it makes sense to work with them. But what about this guy? It's like housing an alien in your lab. It's scary, isn't it? So, do we have anything in common with that one? I don't think so. But, and actually, you know, that we'll show you, it's life cycle. You know about life cycles. It's a human life cycle, so we have a baby, we know that. We're older, the boys with the girl, and they have another babies. That's our cycle. Flies have a different one. This one. And I brought some flies from my lab to show you how they look like. So just grab wires and then give them a little bit further away. So we do have an egg, which is barely visible with the human eye. But then it became a larva that crawls around in that food and eats, became bigger. And actually in the top layer you can probably see the points of the larva crawling. When they're big enough you can actually see them very well. And then they go on the walls of the tube and they pupate. And metamorphosis undergoes, so after they close they give a real fly. And the circle goes again and again. So let's have nothing to do with our cycle. And how it happens that it's actually 5 Nobel Prizes were won for medicine and physiology by studying the fly. How is that? So are we similar more than we think about? We actually are. We do have similar organs and parts like digestive tract or nervous system or, for example, body organization or even the muscle structure itself. That actually is my topic. I'm doing much my thesis about that, but I won't go into details because it's not that interesting. I will have another more interesting topic to discuss. Let's go a little bit into more details. So, body organization. As a fly, we also have a head, thorax, and abdomen. And flies also do that. Another good example is about the nervous system. So, you know, the central nervous system has 2 main parts. It's like brain. Flies also have it. And the spinal cord, which flies also have, but it's called ventral, just because it's here, position. And then all the complex neurons going all over your body, the same for fly, because it should enable different movements in fly. Like flying, it's really complicated, then they need to respond fast. That's why they have a good neural system. But except of that, besides of the like body organization, what about behavior? Do they have something common with the flies in the behavior? I would like to discuss one particular topic of flies. They are drunk. So flies actually can get addicted to alcohol. So, if they have a little bit of alcohol, they are getting hyperactive. As humans do. So they're happy and flying, they're tipsy. With more alcohol, they lose their coordination. So they start pulling on each other, they cannot crawl the walls for a while, and even more alcohol leads to sedative effects. Then they're just, you know, too drunk to move around. It's not all, actually, we do have more. Flies are less choosy when they're drunk, so males tend to hit even other males. Be careful of that. And another effect, which I also found funny is that males that are rejected from females, they tend to drink more after the rejection. That reminds you something. You can correlate with that. So that's all fun and interesting. But how we actually benefit from the fly research and how we won the Nobel Prize with that. So the thing is that between humans and flies, a lot of genes are in common, and actually 75% of mutations that lead to diseases are common between humans and flies. So flies is your organism, so it's easier to find a gene in fly than to relate it to find its brother in another organism that does the same function and looks kind of like in a mama, so like mice and then to human. And if that gene, if mutated, leads to a disease like cancer, you can actually identify drug that working back and forth. So this story that I will tell you started at the 70s with those guys. They were interesting to find out what is with egg of the Drosophila, how it evolves, because it's actually complicated for this small guy. And in the beginning it's just like, yeah, it's oval, nothing going on. But with a period of time, it gets folded properly and segmented. The segments will become the segments of a larva and allow it to crawl around. A lot of stuff going outside and inside, and they're interesting to find out what's actually happening if you disturb this function. So they poison their flies with a known chemical cancerogen, so they caused random mutations all over the genome. Then they collected the mutants that had effect in the egg, so egg looked differently from the normal one. And there was a lot of that massive screen. Yeah, went with many different kinds of. Sometimes you would miss parts of the initial body, like the normal one. Sometimes you would had like two butts instead of two heads. Yeah, just, yeah, but what we were interested in, and I'll talk about is this one, this guy called Hedgehog. And why is that? It's this black dot that you see here. It's actually like imagine skin, it's a spiky cells, they're spiky, and that helps a larva to crawl when it's normally it's in patches. And the spiky cells allow the larva to like grab to the surface and to move itself forward. And here it's just universal distributed, so this one will not move anywhere. They cannot coordinate. And soon enough, they found that it's mutation in that gene. They identified the gene also, and what actually this gene normally doing. So they went back to the wild types, the normal eggs on the fly, to see what's going on. And actually, what this hedgehog do, it's like positioned, let's say, in the upper layer of the surface of the egg, and it gets distributed from one point to another, and it's kind of in a gradient, like starts here in the high, and then it goes out the side, this high gradient, and it goes lower, 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 lower. What it allows is this spike is such to appear. And depending on how much concentration of hedgehog you have, you will have a longer or shorter ones, or like none at all. So that's all nice, and that happens in egg, I said, but it's the hedgehog is not only present in the egg, in the fly. It's also present in a wing. What is it doing there? Actually, it has a similar function, so it's expressed in the back of the wing, and making the cells different in appearance than those front ones. And then the scientists were like, okay, and if I put this protein here, what will happen? And that's what happens. It actually gives a second wing on top growing on normal one. And that's all fascinating and interesting, but how that relates to humans again? And the thing is that it actually relates. So, the stuff that flies have in the wing, people do have when they have two fingers or two toes, and that's called polydactyly, like in Greece. And they went back and saw that this guy, Sonic Hedgehog, in human, this gene, is responsible to that, and it's a friend, let's say, a brother of the hedgehog and the fly. So they are from one family. And it's actually do the same, exactly work the same as trochid flies. So you do have an embryo, it's again expressed in the down part, giving this part of the hand a different appearance from the upper one. And then, if it's again expressed up also, it gives you the additional fingers. So impressive, yeah. But the thing is that this mutation in humans leads to cancer, the skin cancer, in this gene, in the Sonic Hedgehog. Which is not good, but with extensive research on a fly, it was possible to find a drug against the Sonic Hedgehog, and that's called the greatest advance in cancer therapy nowadays. For that particular skin cancer. So that's how flies actually helps. So, and it's even more than that. They can be used for stem cells, for memory, for sleep and jet lags. They also get jet lagged. And addictions like caffeine or alcohol, age and age-related diseases, immunology. So a lot can be studied in flies. And I want to thank you, and maybe if you're interested in fly, you can look at this really nice talk by a fly guy, like a very famous one at TED Talks, called Fly. And this is a movie from one PhD that decided he wanted to be a turn of movies. And they actually did this nice film Fly Room, that's actually like drama and biography about the first fly room, and it was settled in the United States. It's a nice movie to watch and learn more from flies. That's all, I think.
How do you measure jet lag in fly? Like, you said they also have jet lag, so how do you know that the fly is having jet lag?
They usually lose coordination, okay. And it's like behavioral concept, so you look at them and try to fight, and you can try different drugs with them also. To see how they will react, and then relate it to humans.
It was really cool to listen about the different superpowers of flies. Is there some really cool superpower produced by some mutation that could be transplanted to my son or someone, so that he could have it as well? Thanks. Thank you.
Yeah, I don't think that's the idea of having the gene, the genome of the fly in our genome, but they are kind of related to that. That's what you were asking. You want a cool flying gene to your son? We're not so far yet, but ask me in another 50 years maybe. We'll see how that works.